Okay, you can turn in your Bible to Revelation chapter 10. This week we are going to do our study of Revelation chapter 10. What can we as Bible-believing Christians learn from this chapter? Some real good ones this week. There's a couple parts of this, you know, different verses and things that I'd read, and I'd just like, there's something there, I don't know what it is, and prayed about it, and the Lord showed me some very interesting things. So, let's start out here. Verse 1, Revelation chapter 10. And I saw another mighty angel come down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was upon his head, and his face was as it were the sun, and his feet as pillars of fire. All right. Very interesting. This angel has a rainbow upon his head, there it says. Upon his head. And he was clothed with a cloud. What's the significance of that? Go back to Genesis chapter 9. Genesis chapter 9, beginning in verse 8. It says here, "And God spake unto Noah and to his sons with him, saying, And I, behold, I establish my covenant with you and with your seed after you, and with every living creature that is with you, of the fowl, of the cattle, and of every beast of the earth with you, from all that go out of the ark to every beast of the earth. And I will establish my covenant with you, neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of a flood, neither shall there any more be a flood to destroy the earth." Just stop there, right there for a minute. When you think about the flood in the days of Noah, you know, we've all seen flooding at some point in time in your life. You've seen a road covered by a stream or a creek or a river or whatever that came up, went over its banks and flooded a road or flooded a town, and you see water damage or whatever else. We've seen that. But we've never seen anything like this, where the whole world was covered with water and everything died except for what was in that ark. That was a very cruel judgment. Don't think for one minute that it was a nice, peaceful thing and the people just kind of, you know, drowned peacefully. It was a violent, terrible, worldwide judgment. God only judges the world two times in the Bible. Okay, well, I should say three. I'll say it that way. First is the flood in the days of Noah. The second time is going to be the time of Jacob's trouble, which is going to be the worst. The third is actually going to be in 2 Peter, where it talks about the earth being burned up. Okay, three judgments. Interesting. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Nothing to it, I'm sure. But this judgment was terrible. This flood that God did. I mean, things drowned. It was a very, very violent judgment. Let's keep reading here. Verse 12. And God said, "This is the token of the covenant which I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I do set my bow in the cloud." And it shall be a token for a token of a covenant between me and the earth. And it shall come to pass when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud. And I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh. And the bow shall be in the cloud, and I will look upon it, that I may remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is upon the earth. And God said unto Noah, "This is the token of the covenant which I have established between me and all flesh that is upon the earth." What did the angel in Revelation chapter 10 have on his head? Upon his head, a rainbow. What was he clothed with? A cloud. So the rainbow in the cloud. This time it's an angel that comes down and he's got a rainbow upon his head and he's clothed with a cloud. You say, what's the significance? Well, I remember reading back in the book of Matthew, chapter 24, that is in the as in the days of Noah, spelled N-O-E there, Noe, because it's coming from Greek to English. This is Hebrew to English in the Old Testament. As in the days of Noah, so too shall be in the days before the coming of the Son of Man. And then what's it talk about? Marriage? what was going on back there with before the flood. They were messing around with marriage, weren't they? Yeah. Sex perversion. Isn't it ironic that now, today, the rainbow has been usurped, taken over by the sodomite community? The LGBTQ and Lord only knows what else is coming along. It's going to be probably a P on there eventually for pedophile and, B for bestiality and whatever else. I mean, where does it stop? See. But you see, this wickedness, this wicked sodomite movement, these people are so foolish. They don't even know what they're doing. They're using the rainbow as their symbol. And what they're doing actually is putting God's symbol of judgment. It's not, oh, look at the pretty rainbow. You look at the rainbow and you go, wow, that's a reminder. God killed everybody on earth, animals, people, everything, with a horrible flood, a worldwide judgment. That's what you should think of when you see a rainbow up in the clouds. Just go, wow, God sure is powerful. God sure is just. He judges in the earth. It's a sign of his wrath. And he says, okay, I destroyed the earth, and that rainbow is going to be a reminder of that destruction and the fact that I'm not going to destroy it again by a flood. It's kind of interesting because it starts out, the first judgment is water. The second judgment is God's wrath, all sorts of judgments for 7 years. I mean, the flood in the days of Noah is 40 days, 40 nights. It was bad, but 7 years compared to 7 years? Can you imagine? And of course, I'm going to go post-trib because I believe that God, he loved me enough to die for me on the cross, but then he's going to put me through 7 years of judgment, along with the lost world. I mean, the whole rapture issue is really not even that big of a deal. I mean, as far as understanding it, you just look and you go, okay, why would God save me only to put me into a time where I could lose my salvation? The time of Jacob's trouble, and he's pouring out his wrath and judgment upon me. I'm part of his body. I mean, you can get, I get into the whole, all the little details of the, all the little arguments against the, what people call pre-trib rapture, pre-time of Jacob's trouble catching away. But I get into the detail of it, but you really honestly don't need to. As a Bible-believing Christian, you just look and you say, God's not going to put me through that time. But it starts out water. It goes to 7 years of judgment. Horrifying, terrible judgments upon this earth. And it ends with fire. I find that very interesting. And there's probably a whole lot more to that that I'm not going to go into in this study. But how very interesting that God judged the earth the first time because they were messing around with marriage. Messing around with the. Making all kinds of corrupt marriages and things, people coming together to produce children. And now you have sodomy and all kinds of other wickedness. Sex perversion once again, and these stupid people are putting rainbows, a lot of times, on themselves, or they're carrying rainbow flags and things. I mean, it's, it'd be like a Jew in the, and during the height of the Nazi Holocaust years, and he's like, I'm a Jew, and I don't think anybody knows this, but hey, I'm going to take a big Star of David and slap it on my shoulder and just walk down the street. Hey, there's some SS troops. I'll walk over and say hi. But you're insane. I'm going to put a rainbow on and just, be proud of my sin. Yeah. Real intelligent. But let's go back to Revelation chapter 10. Revelation chapter 10, verses 2 through 4. Let's read that. And he had in his hand a little book open, and he set his right foot upon the sea and his left foot on the earth, and cried with a loud voice, as when a lion roareth. And when he had cried, seven thunders uttered their voices. And when the seven thunders had uttered their voices, I was about to write, and I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, Seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered, and write them not. Okay, notice a couple things here. First of all, this term, little book. Now, you're not going to just see this just from looking at here, but if you actually look it up, the term little book only appears in this chapter. Thought that was kind of interesting. It appears four times in chapter 10 and nowhere else in the Bible. Kind of an interesting thing. You say, what's that mean? I don't know. I just thought it was interesting. Four times there. Number two, the second thing you want to look at is the angel's voice is compared to a lion when a lion roareth, it says there. Who's Jesus Christ? The Lion of the tribe of Judah? So this angel is speaking similar to Jesus Christ. Thought that was kind of another interesting thing there. Third, you have seven thunders utter their voices. There's the number seven again, the number of completion, God's number. Seven thunders utter their voices. But the fourth thing is the most important thing to get out of this. Notice it says there in verse 4, seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered and write them not. You get some guy and he comes out today and he says, I'm going to do an expository study of Revelation and I'm going to tell you exactly what's going to happen. No, they're not. No, they're not. Why? Because you're reading something right there. That thing is actually sealed until the people are there in the time of Jacob's trouble. It's not even written in Scripture. It's not even recorded. So don't tell me that somebody today living in the church age is going to understand everything that's going to happen in the time of Jacob's trouble. Don't tell me that they can go through and say, "Well, I'm a Christian today," and I mean, I understand people mean well and stuff like that. I'm not condemning people that write commentaries on Revelation or whatever. I got the Ruckman one right there, and I appreciate some of what he writes and things. And there's been some other great Bible teachers that have expounded on Revelation, fine dandy and everything else. But when it comes right down to it, brethren, we're not going to understand everything in the book of Revelation. All right. There's things going on in the book of Revelation that aren't even written. All right. There's a lot of what's going to be happening in that time period is going to be sight. I mean, we live by faith right now. The just shall live by faith today. It's not going to be that way completely in the time of Jacob's trouble. They're going to be seeing an awful lot of supernatural things. All right, we'll see that as we continue here. Just thought that was very interesting. Verses 5 through 6. And the angel which I saw stand upon the sea and upon the earth lifted up his hand to heaven and swear by him that liveth forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that therein are, and the earth and the things that therein are, and the sea and the things which are therein, that there shall be time no longer. Another very interesting passage of scripture here. Let's look at Matthew chapter 24. You say, well, I don't understand. If there's time no longer, then how would there be time left in the time of Jacob's trouble? You kind of scratch your heads over some of this stuff. Again, don't ever get to a place where you think that you're smart enough to understand the entire book. Okay, that's never going to happen. All right, God will show you some things, but this book, I mean, it's a very aptly named last book there, the book of Revelation, because it's going to be revealed to the people that are in that time. I'm preaching it right now as a Christian preacher in the church age that's looking at this thing for instruction in righteousness. Right, I am not going to understand everything that's going on there. But I find this very interesting that there should be time no longer. What's going on there? Matthew chapter 24, verse 21 and 22. For then shall be great tribulation, such as was not since the beginning of the world to this time, no, nor ever shall be. And except those days should be shortened, there should no flesh be saved, but for the elect's sake, those days shall be shortened. There is going to be a supernatural shortening of the time. So when the time that's that when the angel comes and he says there's time no longer, I believe what's going on is the set 24-hour day and 7-day week, that's done away with. Whether the actual days go down to 20-hour days or there's one less day of the week or I have no idea. But the fact of the matter is time, the set time that we've had from the beginning of the creation, something changes. And could it be that there we go into the millennial kingdom and that time is still changed from what we currently have? And that's why there's going to be so much, you know, growing of agriculture and things like that. The gardening and thing is just going to be amazing in that time. I know when I was in Alaska years ago, I had a brother that was living there, went to see him. And I mean actual flesh and blood brother, you know, not spiritual, but we went there and it was weird. I mean, it was like, it was, you know, it didn't get to be, you know, the sun really didn't go down till like 11 o'clock at night, you know, and then it really didn't go down that much. You know, it was still fairly bright outside and, you know, and then it's up again in no time at all. You know, so very interesting. If the whole world would be changed in things, might get pretty interesting in the millennial kingdom. Go next to Mark chapter 13. We're going to see the parallel passage to this Matthew chapter 24 thing about the days being shortened. Mark 13, verse 19 and 20. We'll see the same thing here. For in those days shall be affliction such as was not from the beginning of the creation which God created unto this time, neither shall be. And except that the Lord had shortened those days, no flesh should be saved. But for the elect's sake, whom he hath chosen, he hath shortened the days. Okay, so, you know, I just find it interesting that time, when time is no longer there, it's, you know, I don't believe that, obviously there has to be some semblance of time. It isn't just going to, everything's just going to stop and it's never going to be night again or something. I believe, no, that it's shortening of the days. But I'm going to show you another very interesting thing. Turn back to Daniel chapter 7. Back to your Old Testament. Daniel chapter 7. Verse 25. And I believe these verses here in Daniel 7, this part here, is talking about the Antichrist when he comes. Daniel 7:25 says, "And he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High." Compare that to Revelation 13. "And think to change times and laws." The Antichrist is going to think to change times and laws. Very interesting. And look what happens. "And they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of times." Or dividing of time, excuse me. Very interesting. So the Antichrist wants to change time, and it's actually given into his hand to do. How about that? Go back to Revelation chapter 10. So you're actually going to have a, you know, time there in this time of Jacob's trouble where it's going to be a totally different world. I mean, you're going to have the judgments and all this other stuff going on, and time is going to change. I mean, that's why I say you're crazy if you think that you can explain this whole book of Revelation. You see these guys, you know, "I did a study on the book of Revelation." Yeah, and you probably don't know half of what's actually going to happen. Revelation chapter 10, verse 7. Here's another good one. "But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, as he hath declared to his servants, the prophets." Now, I've talked about this thing before. You know, I say, well, in this time period, you know, people are going to understand that God is real and everything that's there. And so there's no longer going to be any atheists. Yeah, sure. You can get that from the text there. But I looked at it and I thought, I prayed about it and I said, "Lord, what? There's a couple of things that are bugging me about this. I don't really understand. First of all, what is the mystery of God? And it's finished. And when did you declare this to your servants, the prophets, in the Old Testament?" And I'm going, okay, I'll have to do a little word study. I'm going to have to do some research on this. You know, what is this mystery of God, and where in the prophets does it show up? Because if you don't know, if you're newly saved, when you read about the prophets in the Gospels, you will, you know, what's being referred to is Isaiah through Ezekiel would be like the major prophets, and then Daniel the whole way through Malachi would be the minor prophets. Okay, I think I have that correct. And those are the prophets. When you read about the prophets, references to the prophets, that's there. So I thought, okay, well, then it should be a fairly easy task. I should just basically, all I'd really have to do is look up mystery of God, and it'll be, some Old Testament references there in one of the prophets, Book of the Prophets. So I looked it up, and the number of references to mystery of God in that, in the prophets, is zero. I'm thinking, okay, well, but it says in the prophets there, as he hath declared to his servants the prophets. Well, what in the world's going on here? So I thought, well, I'll go through these references to the mystery of God, see what the Lord shows me. Pretty good stuff. Mark chapter 4. Turn to Mark chapter 4. All the references to mystery of God are in the New Testament. I'm going to show you why. If you're not dispensational, you might as well just shut it off right about here, because it's another proof for dispensational teaching. Mark chapter 4, verse 11 through 12. Okay, here's the first time that this phrase, it doesn't line up exactly the mystery of God, but it's you'll kind of see it there. Mark chapter 4, verse 11. And he said unto them, unto you it is given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God. So it picked it up, mystery of God. But unto them that are without, all these things are done in parables, that seeing they may see and not perceive, and hearing they may hear and not understand, lest at any time they should be converted and their sins should be forgiven them. Now, if you want a good cross-reference to that, the reason I brought this one up, I would have normally just left that out, but this is very important to understand this. Why did Jesus speak in parables thing? What's going on there? Well, what was happening is Jesus was coming down and he's basically saying, I'm going to speak in parables because most of these people honestly are not here to hear the truth. They're here to see the show, the miracles. That's why most of those people followed Jesus. They weren't really there trying to be convicted of their sins. They're going, wow, you see that guy over there? Dude, hey, look at that. There's a guy without any legs. Watch. This is what he just did. You see those legs come out? Wasn't that amazing? Wow, isn't that great? Hey, there's that blind beggar. Watch, I bet you he's going to heal. Ooh, wow, wasn't that exciting? So Jesus teaches them doctrinally. He says, okay, you people really aren't here. I know your heart, so I'm just going to speak in parables. You're not going to get it. And a lot of people come to this book with a skeptical mind. They come and they say, well, I can point out errors in it, and I can do this and I can do that. And if you read over in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 19, it talks about how that God takes the wise in their own craftiness. He'll actually use their intelligence to deceive them. So they come along, I have too high of an IQ. And the Lord's like, yeah, you sure, certainly do. You've been educated beyond your own intelligence. All right. You're now crazy. You're now nutty. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, says in Romans chapter 1. But that's what happens with these people. And so God will actually deceive them, very much the same way he did with the parables. If you don't come in the right spirit, God's not going to show you the truth. All right? And that's very important to understand about the mystery of God. We're going to see that as we continue. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Go there next. It's the next reference to the mystery of God. And I realize that that first one there is not really a reference. It's the mystery of the kingdom of God. But, the kingdom of God, Romans chapter 14, verse 17, just flipping by it here, it says, for the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost, spiritual fellowship. So the mystery of the kingdom of God there, if you want to have spiritual fellowship with Almighty God, you need to come to him in the right spirit, with a believing spirit. But let's check out 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 3 through 8. It says here, and I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor of the princes of this world that come to naught. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Yeah. I know my grandfather used to say, I don't remember the exact saying, but he was a chalk talk artist and saved man and everything. And he would say, I forget the exact thing how it goes, but something to the effect of, if every man knew what a man dies and knows like 5 minutes after his death, everybody would be saved. In other words, if you could see what happens 5 minutes after you die, right after your death, in other words, I realize there's no time in eternity, I know, but you know, if you knew what you're facing in eternity, and when you see that, if people could see it right now in this life, nobody would be lost. Everybody would get saved. You know, and it's the same thing if people knew who Jesus really was. If they had come to him with a desire to learn who he really was, they wouldn't have crucified him. Interesting. But we see there in verse 7, we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory. What is that mystery? What is the mystery of God? Let's see about this. Ephesians chapter 3. You can do your own search in this thing, your own word study here. I mean, just go and if you have a computer program like Sword Searcher is what I use. There's a bunch of others. But you just type in mystery of God and it'll come up with these different references. You know, these aren't ones that the Lord revealed to me, you know, and whatever. This is just a word study. But he'll reveal interesting things to you when you do a word study. Ephesians chapter 3, beginning in verse 1. For this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, which is given me to you ward, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery, as I wrote afore in few words, the mystery of God. Whereby when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge in the mystery of Christ, also called the mystery of Christ. We'll see that as we continue. Which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto us, his holy apostles and prophets, by the Spirit. Wait a second. No, that's not true. Because you see, as a Baptist, I preach that everybody has been saved the same way from Genesis to Revelation. Salvation has always been the same. You know, no, I'm afraid that's a lie. Ephesians chapter 3, if you want to nail somebody that's non-dispensational, Ephesians chapter 3. And if they reject that, well, they're lost. Just as simple as that. I mean, it's like right there. It spells it out. You know, in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men. You know, well, I think they got saved by looking forward to the cross. Well, you're crazy. We're just reading this morning in our morning devotions, Luke chapter 18, and it talks about Jesus, you know, it tells the disciples, his own disciples, what kind of death he's going to die. And they're going, I don't know. I don't understand, you know. And you see that over and over again in the Gospels. They don't even understand what Jesus is saying to them when he explains to them he's going to die on the cross. They don't understand it. You know, so anybody that says to you that they got saved by looking forward to the cross, they are a liar, an absolute total liar. But let's continue. Verse 6, that the Gentiles should be fellow heirs and of the same body and partakers of his promise in Christ by the gospel, whereof I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God given unto me by the effectual working of his power. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. Hidden. Not known. Why doesn't the mystery of God show up in the Old Testament? You know why? Because it was hidden. Until Paul, it's given to Paul. We just read about it right here. Verse 2, if ye have heard of the dispensation of the grace of God, God has always dispensed grace. Okay? Paul's not saying that we have our dispensation is called the grace of God. No, 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 no. God dispenses grace in different ways. So God, when he dispensed grace to Paul, he said, hey, Paul, here's the grace I'm dispensing to you, and this is the gospel that I'm going to reveal to you. Grace coming, and here's the gospel. Verse 3, how that by revelation he made known unto all Christians the mystery. No, it says me. Paul, you see. And I see people, you know, well, it's heresy to say Paul or the Gospels, you know, Paul and stuff like that. You don't know the Bible. Incredible. Turn next to Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1, verse 25 through 29. If Ephesians chapter 3 wasn't enough for you, they will go here to Colossians chapter 1. Whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God, even the mystery which hath been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. You talk about something that our brains, our puny little brains, can't even fathom. Christ in you? One passage talks about women, you know, adorning themselves in modest apparel, that the hidden men, about the hidden man of the heart. Christ in you? God of the universe? We're connected to his body? Huh? I believe it. Why? Bible says it. Do I understand it with my mind? Can I draw it out and whatever? No, I can't. I just believe it. The just shall live by faith. You see. Verse 28. Whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. Whereunto I also labor, striving according to his working, which worketh in me mightily. Interesting. Whom we preach, warning every man. Judgment, you see. Very interesting. It's kind of funny, like when you think of Paul being on trial, you know, and I think it was King Agrippa, you know, and he talked about reason, you know, Paul's reasoning of things, and he says, and of judgment to come, Felix trembles, you know, one of the authorities there. He trembled. Judgment to come. Warning every man. The old hellfire and damnation, hellfire and brimstone preacher, are you? Yes. Yes. Okay. I preach Jesus Christ. Why? Because there's a place called hell down there where you're going to burn, and you're going to burn, and you're going to burn, and then when you're going to go up at the great white throne judgment, you get judged, final judgment, and you go to the great, or to a lake of fire. And you burn forever. I preach Jesus. Why? Because I believe in the eternal damnation of the wicked. Terrible thing. But again, we see there, it's the mystery of God, the mystery that's been hidden. That's why you don't see it in the Old Testament. You say, but who's the prophets? Don't get ahead of me. We're going to get there. All right? Just, you know, I know when you're a Bible-believing Christian, it's just like you get so anxious and you're just like, well, what about this? What about that? You know, you just like, you're really inquisitive, like a little child, you know. You're just like, oh, can I play with that now? Oh, you know. It's great. It's wonderful. You know, the gifts that the Lord bestows upon us as his children. But anyhow, let's continue. Colossians chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. We'll see another reference here to the mystery of God. We'll actually see the actual wording this time. Colossians chapter 2, verse 1. For I would that ye knew what great conflict I have for you, and for them at Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh. That would include us. We haven't seen his face in the flesh. That their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God, and of the Father, and of Christ, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. For though I be absent in the flesh, Paul's not here right now, yet am I with you in the spirit. You know, it's just, I got to push a little pause button there. Isn't it interesting when you read through the Pauline epistles, how much you can relate to Paul? As you grow as a Christian, you can relate. You can say, yeah, you know, persecutions, distresses, by evil report, by good report, you know, as deceivers and yet true, you know. You go through things. Paul's with us in spirit. Pretty neat. Unpause. Okay, here we go. Joying and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Don't put your faith in other Christians. Don't put your faith in preachers. Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. He's the only one that's never going to let you down. You know, if you take your eyes off of Jesus and you put it on the world and you put it on family and you put it on possessions and you put it on even preachers and things like that, you're going to see they're going to fail you. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, you know, and look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. It's an old hymn. See? What is the mystery of God? It's the gospel that's been committed to us. It's been hidden from the people in the Old Testament. To a Jew, it's a stumbling block. They look and they go, what? What are you talking about? Our Messiah, when he comes, he's going to be a man of world peace. And they're expecting the whole thing. They don't see the fact that, no, he came and he's been rejected. They kind of ignore some parts there in Zechariah and things. When they see him, they say, you know, what are these wounds that you've received and things? And he's like, you know, I was wounded in the house of my friends. And they mourn when they see him and things. They kind of ignore that. They just say, oh, no, our Messiah, when he comes, he fulfills the whole thing. And you say, what about the virgin birth? Well, actually, we don't believe in that anymore. You know, and that's what goes on. They're not looking for the real Messiah there. And that's why the Lord's going to be punishing them in the time of Jacob's trouble. And sending them lots of signs and wonders to confirm the word. He's going to send them Moses and Elijah, 144,000, you know, sealed Jews. I mean, it's what it's all about, you see. But the mystery that was hidden from them has been revealed to us. So we are the ones that have the mystery of God. And we're going to get to the prophets thing, so just hold on. We're getting there. Colossians chapter 4, verse 2 through 5. See another reference to it here. Continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving, with all praying also for us, that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ. For which I am also in bonds, that I may make it manifest as I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without, redeeming the time. You can keep reading there too. It's, you know, a lot of good stuff. But the whole thing is, we are supposed to speak. We have the mystery of God committed to us, but we're supposed to speak the mystery of Christ. Right? It says there, you know, with all praying also for us, that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ. How do you speak the mystery of Christ? Glad you asked. 1 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. Mystery of God. It says here, mystery of godliness. How about that? What separates us from all other systems of belief? The thing that separates us as Bible-believing Christians is our God became a man and walked down here on the earth. all the false cults, their God is somebody that is so different from us, so high up, so holy, you just can't even relate to the guy. You know, I mean, a good question to ask a Muslim is, what did Allah do for you personally? Nothing. You know, can you know him on a personal level? Of course not. Can you see him as a loving father? Obviously not. You know, my God came down here and lived in a body of corruptible flesh. It wasn't like when he was on the cross there and they hammered a nail and he was just like, oh yeah, I'm supposed to act like it hurt. Oh, ow. He felt it. He felt the pain. He experienced being down here in this body, walking around on this earth and seeing the vexation and things like this. I mean, he's walking around. He understands people's thoughts. I'm glad I don't have that power. It'd be very, very, very vexing. You know, it's bad enough under, you know, hearing people what they're saying, much less reading their thoughts. That'd be bad. But, you know, he's down here on this earth. You know, the book of Hebrews talks about that he's, you know, he was in all points tempted, you know, and things, but without sin, you know. And it's just like, you know, our God came here, lived for 33 and a half years, was crucified, and then he rose from the dead, rose from the grave. Nobody else has that. So what is the mystery of God? The mystery of God is what was revealed through Paul to the Gentiles, that God was manifest in the flesh, and that he died on the cross, and he was buried, and he rose from the dead, and he's coming back. We'll talk about that here as we continue. But you say, okay, the prophets thing. Are we at the prophets thing yet? Okay, all right, okay. You know, we'll do that now. Revelation chapter 19. He revealed it to the prophets. You say, I don't understand that. You know, hold on. Revelation chapter 19, verse 10. And I fell at his feet to worship him. This is right after the marriage of the Lamb there, his bride and things like that. We are the bride of Christ, so we are involved in this. Revelation 19, verse 10, and I fell at his feet to worship him, and he said unto me, see, thou do it not. I am thy fellow servant and of thy brethren that have the testimony of Jesus. So this angel that John is speaking with, he is a redeemed saint. He has the testimony of Jesus. He's of, you know, I am thy fellow servant and of thy brethren. Okay, look what he says. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Keep your hand there and go back to Revelation chapter 10. Revelation chapter 10, verse 7, the last part. As he hath declared to his servants the prophets. Notice the wording there in that verse. It doesn't say, as it is written in the prophets, as he hath declared to his servants the prophets. For the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Do you have a testimony of Jesus changing your life? Are you an ambassador for Jesus Christ? Are you saved? Then you have the spirit of prophecy. And the mystery has been revealed to you. The mystery of God. How about that? Turn back to Revelation chapter 10. Verse 7 there, the mystery of God should be finished as he hath declared to his servants the prophets. You know, I'd almost be tempted to say this is another proof for the saints, Christians, not being there in the time of Jacob's trouble. You see, because the mystery of God is finished in that time period. The gospel that's been revealed to us through Paul is not preached in that time. Why? There's no eternal security of the believer in that time period. The just shall live by faith. We walk by faith. Oh, well, still somewhat there in the time of Jacob's trouble, but not like today. Why? Time of Jacob's trouble, you're going to be seeing the book of Revelation come to pass. They'll be seeing angels. They'll be seeing spiritual beings and seeing the mighty hand of God of His judgment coming down upon the earth. It isn't the same as what we have today. I'd be tempted to use it for another argument against the whole post-trib thing, but I won't use it because there's plenty of other ones. But it is a good argument. But let's continue. Verse 8, Revelation chapter 10, verse 8 through 10. We'll read these verses. And the voice which I heard from heaven spake unto me again, and said, Go and take the little book which is open in the hand of the angel which standeth upon the sea and upon the earth. And I went unto the angel and said unto him, Give me the little book. And he said unto me, Take it, and eat it up, and it shall make thy belly bitter, but it shall be in thy mouth sweet as honey. And I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it up, and it was in my mouth sweet as honey, and as soon as I had eaten it, my belly was bitter. Another little neat thing for instruction in righteousness. Kind of neat. Did you ever get a truth from the Lord and it's so sweet, it's just like you're reading the Bible and you go, whoa, that's like exactly what's going on. Or I'm going through this exact thing and you're just like, whoa, okay, wow. And you're like all excited and everything, and you forget yourself and you go down and you have a lost friend or a lost relative or whatever else, and you're like, you're not going to believe what the Lord showed me. Man, it's so incredible. And you're like excited and you go, and you tell them, and they just like, you know, I'm getting a little bit worried about you. I mean, you're really going off the deep end. You are coming up with some weird stuff. I've never even heard that. Okay, I've gone to church all my life and nobody's ever preached this before. You're getting into some cult type of, you know, and that sweet thing that was in your mouth that the Lord just fed you from His word, now all of a sudden has made you have a sick stomach. Your belly becomes bitter. Because you love that person. You love that relative. You love that friend. And you go, I was just trying to show you the thing. Now your belly's bitter. I'll give you a couple examples. Here's the sweet. God's Word. Wow. This is actually God's Word. This King James Bible. Wow, it's such an amazing thing to be actually able to hold the very words of God. Wow, this is great. How's it get bitter? Well, your lost relatives that are using the new versions. And you go and you say, I want to tell you about the Bible version issue. And the new versions, you know, like your NIV, they took out all these verses and things like this, and they changed this, and they changed that. And they go, you're into that King James only cult, aren't you? You're getting wacko. And they start screaming at you, and it turns into a huge argument. And you're going, but I didn't mean it that way. I meant, you know, like, it's a sweet thing. It's wonderful to have God's word, you know? And you're like, you know. And then it's like, they don't want to talk to you and stuff. And, you know, and I have people written to me and they're like, you know, I'm not even allowed to see my grandchildren anymore because of this stuff. Yeah. Sweet to our mouth, but sure, it gets bitter in the belly when we try to share it with other people. I'll give you another one. Jesus saved me and I'm going to heaven. Is that sweet? Oh yeah. What a wonderful thing. You know, I mean, another old hymn, you know, what a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. And you're all excited and everything. And you go out and you tell your friends and you go, I'm saved. I'm going to heaven. What are you saying to them? You're lost and going to hell. And all of a sudden, instead of them rejoicing with you, they get bitter and they attack you. And you come away from the experience going, I was happy. I was really doing good. And now I feel sick to my stomach. Have you been there? Give you one more. The rapture is coming soon. You know, you see some kind of a thing. I mean, right now there's like all this attention on Jerusalem, you know, and you're like kind of looking at the news going like, you know, the Arabic world, the Palestinian leader, you know, whatever the name is, and I'm a big a fat or whatever, you know. And, you know, he's like, you know, if you move the United States Embassy to Jerusalem from Tel Aviv, you know, it's going to spark, you know, we'll release the gates of hell upon the, you know, America and whatever else and stuff like this. We're going to start a war, you know, and everything. And there's like, I just saw a report today. They're saying that there's like tens of thousands of missiles pointed at Israel right now, you know, and all this stuff. And it's just like, as Christians, we're kind of like looking going, you know, what's going on over there, you know? Oh, we need to think about the Middle East peace process. It's like, really? You know? Because that's what the Antichrist comes and does. So that means if they get close, the closer we get to that thing happening, the closer the rapture's coming. And it's exciting, you know? And you're like, wow. And you tell, you know, you get in your circle of friends and whatever else, and you go, you know, I think the rapture's coming soon. You know, I'm going to get to go see Jesus soon, and we're going to get to see all the saints, and it's exciting, and you're happy. And they go, did you know that that thing's a lie? It was created in 1830 by John Nelson Darby. And actually before him, he got it from Jesuits. You know, they wrote the whole thing. There is no pre-trib rapture. We're going to be here for the whole thing. We're going to go through it. And somebody else says, well, I think we'll go through half of it. Well, yeah, but we're going to have to endure to the end to be saved. And what started out sweet in the mouth becomes very bitter in the belly. And it all goes back to the book. And some people, they get into this thing and they think to themselves, you know, I don't think it's supposed to be this rough. I mean, I thought that there should be more unity and more this and more that. Well, you know, that's not what the Bible teaches. If you are in the Bible-believing movement, you're going to see the strife that goes on. There's a lot of lost people that try to get into the movement and are seriously sowing division and discord among the brethren. And it's rough. And it's rough, too, because, you know, I know a lot of people, you get saved early on and you're just like, wow, there's a lot of Christians. I'm like related to lots of Christians and there's Christians all over the place. And you get to studying the Word of God more and you're like, hey, you go to your Christian relatives and you say, check out what the Lord showed me. And all of a sudden they're yelling and screaming at you and acting like lost people act. And you're going, huh? And all of a sudden you start to realize, oh, there's a Christian relatives and the Christian friends and everything else, they're not Christians. And you start thinking, well, who's saved? You know? It's rough, isn't it? But let's finish up here. One final little jab here. Convicting. Revelation chapter 10, verse 11. And he said unto me, thou must prophesy again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings. And, you know, you can get in all excited into that. You know, well, did John, you know, is John going to be resurrected? You know, is it going to be Moses, Elijah, and John? Well, I don't know. I mean, this is stuff, like I said, I mean, there's things going on. You have back there in verse 4, seal up those things which the seven thunders uttered and write them not. I mean, that's going to be revealed in the time. It's not even written in Scripture. It's going to be revealed in that time of Jacob's trouble. What goes on here? Is John actually resurrected? I mean, and there's a verse about, you know, the disciples and things, they might be resurrected. And there's arguments this way and arguments that way. People in the church age trying to look out into the future. We have no idea what's going to happen other than what the Lord reveals to us as Christians today. But instruction in righteousness here, brethren. What can we learn? What can we take from this? And he said unto me, thou must prophesy again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings. Breaking news. We're not really sure what happened, but it turns out that a lot of people disappeared. We don't know the number right now, but it seems that this King James only cult, I don't know if I'd say that, but you know, stick with me. These people that held the King James Bible, it appears as though they've created some kind of a terrorist attack or something where they've vaporize themselves. They're gone. It's not the rapture, because there's still a lot of good Christians here. You know, I mean, joining us now is Rick Warren. Pastor Warren, what do you think this is? Well, there was a radical sect of people that were very much anti-Catholic. They held to these King James Bibles, and they obviously did something very violent. We're just all in shock, and our prayers go out to the families involved. And you know, see what I'm saying? What's going to be your testimony that you leave behind when the rapture happens? Is it going to be here to prophesy again before many peoples and nations and tongues and kings? What is the legacy that you're going to leave behind, Christian? I have to ask myself that question. What is it that I'm going to be leaving behind? Because whatever we leave behind as Christians is going to prophesy. It's going to show the testimony of Jesus. Are you a Christian? Do you live like a Christian? Do you have things in your home that are Christian? Do you have things in your home that would be displeasing to the Lord? What is your testimony? What are you leaving behind to prophesy before the world when we leave? Let's close with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I know all of us are longing for the day when you take us out of here. And the reason that you haven't done it yet, Lord, is because it's not in your timing, number one, but number two, we have a lot of work to do yet. And I just pray, Lord, that you would just speak to each one of the saved brethren right now that's out there watching this, that you would convict of sin if there is anything there that they need to get cleaned up, that you would help all of us to continue to stay in your word, to stand strong, not back down, and not give up the mystery of God that you have revealed to us. And I thank you, Lord, for revealing that to us. And Lord, I do pray that you would give each of us opportunities to witness for thee, and give us the courage and the conviction to do it, and to keep our not keep our mouths shut, I'll say it that way, but to speak boldly as we ought to speak. And Lord, I just ask that you would please keep us safe as well in these very troubled times. And I pray all these things in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, that is going to be it for Revelation chapter 10. You know, there's a lot of deep meanings in Scripture, and it never ceases to amaze me how much, when you read the Bible on the surface, it's just kind of like, okay, you know, it's nice, you know, sure, you know, but it's the Lord expects you to go back over some things and dig a little bit deeper. He wants to know you on a personal level. You know, the Bible talks about that when a husband marries a wife, that he's to know her. And that's talking about the marriage bed, but it's also talking about a good husband will want to know his wife, her thoughts, what upsets her, what makes her happy, what makes her laugh, what knowing. And that's what we should desire with the Lord. That's why I say you can have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. He will deal with you personally. And, you know, you can just read through the Bible, and I've seen these people, you know, I read through the Bible 300 times a year or whatever else, and I'm going, okay, you can read through it and just, you're not getting to know the Lord. There's a lot of people that use this Bible, that read this Bible, and they don't know the Lord. All right? You want to get to know the Lord and get to know this book, it's going to take some time. It's going to take some study. I mean, there are times, you know, I've gone through some of these chapters in Revelation. It's like, wow, it's pretty good stuff there, Lord, and that's pretty good, and this is pretty good. Other times I read through it, and I just go, I didn't see a single thing in that whole chapter. Just like, what can we use for instruction in righteousness? I don't see anything, you know? And I go through it again, and I go through it again, and I go through it again. I'll read through these chapters sometimes, you know, I don't even know how many times, quite a few times. Just, you know, maybe 20 times or something like that, just verse by verse by verse, and stopping on words. And okay, Lord, what is this? What are you trying to say here? Is this something I can, you know, just like, okay, And, you know, it's that way with my wife. I was a single man for 36 years, and I'm married now and everything, and it's just like there's times when I'm just like, hey, I got stuff to do, I don't really care to listen to you right now or something. And I have to stop myself and say, no, that's not right. I need to take time and hear what she's trying to say to me. What's that way with our relationship to the Lord? We have to get to a point where we say, okay, Lord, I'm not just going to get my Bible reading in for the day. I want to know, is there something here I'm missing? And when the Lord starts to deal with you on that intimate level where He says, hey, you know what? Why don't you give that up for me? And sometimes the Lord will not, He'll not ask you to give up, He's not just saying, hey, give up alcohol or pornography or some other wicked thing. Sometimes He wants you to give up something that's not even necessarily bad, but it's going to make your relationship that much closer. And I can't answer what it is for you. I can't give you a little formula to find out what things you. No, it's between you and Him. I can't fill in that relationship little gap there, okay? It's between you and the Lord. And be open to that. Because that's where true intimacy with the Lord comes in. Where you will, I hear Christians, newer Christians, they'll say, you say the Lord showed you this, or Lord showed you that. Well, part of that is I try not to take credit for what truth, the Lord gives me. And I say, well, the Lord showed me that, He led me to this or whatever else. But it does go to a level where the Lord will actually speak to you, and it's not an audible voice that you can hear all of a sudden and you're like talking back and forth. It'll be kind of a thought that'll come into the mind, and you do it and you go, wow, that's amazing. Right there, the Bible says that, or this, or whatever. And the more little things you give up, the closer that relationship gets. And that's our purpose here on this earth. Revelation chapter 4 talks about that. For thy pleasure that they are and were created. We're created for God's pleasure, to bring Him joy, to bring Him pleasure. That's the whole point of our life as a Christian. All right? Witnessing to the lost is there and everything else, but that's part of the thing of bringing God pleasure. So, but it just, I just want to encourage you. Take time to really meditate upon the scriptures. Again, the devil perverts so much of what the Lord does, well, pretty much everything the Lord does. And they have this meditation stuff, and you sit there and you meditate and you think about some object in the room or whatever else. Stupid. A Christian, your form of meditation is you read something in scripture and you say, the mystery of God as He hath declared unto His servants the prophets. Okay. And you walk around, you're like, okay, I gotta get supper ready, and you're getting sitting there getting food ready, and you're going, mystery of God. Oh yeah, okay, can you put the plates on the table over there? Yeah, good job. And things like this. Mystery of God. I wonder what that means. Could that be the was probably has something to do with Him coming and being manifest in the flesh, but oh yeah, okay, let's sit down and pray. We'll eat, and you're eating, talking and stuff like this, and in your mind you're going, I got to find out what the mystery of God is. That's meditating upon the Word of God, And when you get into that practice, when you get into really studying the scriptures and saying, okay, Lord, show me what's going on here, that relationship to the Lord will become that much stronger. So, just a really, really, really an amazing, chapter. And I'm enjoying this study. It's something that I've always wanted to do, teaching on Revelation, but it's always bugged me. Like, I don't think I'm supposed to know exactly what's going on here because it's not my dispensation. What can I learn from it? And Lord gave me this idea, go about it for instruction in righteousness. And it's challenging, not always easy going through this thing, but it is really enjoyable. And I know a lot of, I mean, we've gotten a lot of letters, a lot of emails and things from people saying how much you enjoy this study. And I thank the Lord for that. Praise the Lord. And I hope I challenge you. I hope you aren't just here to be entertained. I hope that it's actually changing your life, and that it's drawing you closer to the Lord Jesus Christ, not to me. Don't draw closer to me, okay? You should stay away from the screen, okay, the computer screen, because there's electrical frequencies that come off. But that's going to be it. We will see you in the next one, Revelation chapter 11. Got a couple other videos I'll probably be bringing out between now and chapter 11. But thank you very much for watching. We will see you in the next video.